I will switch to English now. As I said before, the best language to conduct a debate on French politics. And it's my pleasure to invite to the stage Natalie Nougayrede and Christophe de Voogd. We agreed that you would sit in the middle, Natalie, and Christophe would be there, and I would be on the side because I'm just your moderator. Ladies and gentlemen, Natalie Nougayrede, si je prononce bien votre nom, is a member of the editorial board of The Guardian and a commentator for that journal. Since 2 years?
October 2014.
Since yes. October 2014. Before then, you were at Le Monde for almost 20 years, I would say. Mm. Yeah. And you ended up as editor-in-chief. Yeah. Christophe de Voogd, professeur de rhétorique politique. You teach at Sciences Po. And when you say Sciences Po, you always have to say prestigious. It's the epitheton of the Sciences Po. It's a very prestigious school of French politics. And other than that, you are associated with a think tank called Fondapol. And there you just published a very nice little book called Aidez-moi Christophe pour un instant. Quel discours
pour convaincre.
Pour convaincre. You say in that book that la seule exception française qui existe vraiment, the only French exception that still really exists, is the fact that it's the last large European economy that's not yet reformed, that still remains anchored in its old welfare state system, and you look for a new discourse to open up that possibility of reform. Am I right?
You're right. But also about immigration and integration. We need a new way of speaking. Yeah.
My first question to both of you would be a personal question, and then later on we can learn a lot from your professional look on things as a journalist and a professor. But as French citizens, as European individuals, please tell me, and let me start with you, Natalie, what's at stake in these coming French elections? How does it matter to your heart?
It matters immensely to my heart as a French citizen, as a European, as a journalist who cares about the institutions of a healthy democracy. In a nutshell, I think democracy is at stake in my country, France, with these elections, because I do believe that although it is not the likeliest scenario, there is a possibility that Marine Le Pen would be elected. It's not the most likely outcome, but I think we cannot exclude it. And for me, that would mean a severe threat to democracy in France. And as a result of that, I think it's a test for democracy in Europe, because this will be arguably the biggest electoral test in Europe this year. The elections in this country were extremely important. The elections in Germany will be extremely important. But in France, because of the stakes and because of some of the problems that you've hinted to, and because of France's role historically in the European project alongside Germany, if we have an electoral accident in May, I think it would be the beginning of the end of the European project, because Marine Le Pen as president would start unraveling the project. Her election would in itself kill the spirit of the European project.
We will dwell upon that later on. Yeah. So if I listen to you as a concerned French citizen, I hear some genuine fear.
Yes.
You are worried about, because you yourself, you live in London now.
Yes, I fear a bad outcome. I hope for a good outcome, mm-hmm. a healthy outcome, not Marine Le Pen. Uh-huh. But I fear a bad outcome, and as a French person living in London now for 2 years and a half, I've witnessed Brexit, and believe me, all my friends, all my British friends, believed that Brexit would never happen, mm-hmm. and for months and months, and the polls were sometimes tight, but everybody was saying, in the end, mm-hmm. reason will prevail. Yeah. You know, surely they will. People Just will not go to that extreme. And it happened, and it showed me that however astute we try to be when we look at our societies, our European societies, I feel and that I and many of the people I spend a lot of time with are actually in a bubble, that we are not fully aware of what's going on elsewhere, and it's a terrible thing to say as a journalist, but we are to a degree disconnected from the deeper fabrics of our societies. I saw this in Britain, and I think it exists in France as well.
Well, that's a very honest statement, I think, for a journalist.
It's a reality.
That's why she went to England.
You still live in Paris, although you spent a lot of time also in the south of France to teach. The same question to you, as a citizen, as a Frenchman, what's at stake? How do you feel?
Well, it's difficult always to, just a bit like Natalie, it's difficult to separate really what you are and
of course,
and your job, you know. I would say, well, I will give an answer maybe more as a historian, which was before I'm a historian. So a bit like Natalie, I think, as a historian, you must never exclude possibilities. And I still feel that in France, especially in the media sphere and in the political sphere, there is still, it's less and less, but there is still the general idea that whoever is against Marine Le Pen for the second round will win. Mm-hmm. You know, a horse would win against Marine Le Pen.
It will be two horses.
Yeah, well, she's of the clever type of horses. And so this illusion is still there. I'm afraid that it will go on and on a bit, and I can still hear it a bit in many circles in France, also in Holland, by the way. Mm-hmm. So the question is really complex. I've never been so uncertain about the French result ever. Things were much clearer, Natalie, in all the previous elections. Mm-hmm. Of course, you had always a margin of 1-2%, but it was always the only comparison, and we can draw a parallel with Holland, is of course the referendum of 2005, which I think is a start of everything, because it's a kind of Brexit avant la lettre, the no of the French and the Dutch. Mm-hmm. So, and at that time already, the commentators used to say, it's impossible, reason will prevail. Well, I don't know if it's reason or not, but anyway, it did not prevail. Mm-hmm. So, and we did not listen enough to the message. And I think in Holland as well, by the way. Mm-hmm. I like to be a bit comparative here. Huh? So, you know,
yes. I appreciate
the follow-up.
It.
And so we did not, and I think we precisely because we, that's as a specialist of rhetoric also, there is also an inclination to deny the problems. I mean, there are problems. There are problems linked with immigration. There are problems in the area which are not only linked to, let's say, segregation. Mm-hmm. There are also problems linked with the rise of a radical Islam that exists. I mean, you cannot hide it. And if you go to the banlieues, I do, you see it clearly. And you see the difference with 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. The difference is clear. Mm-hmm. So there are problems. And I think the political class did not really handle the problems. There was a kind of policy of let's forget about it and everything will be, at the end of the day, great. So I'm always afraid that when you things were a bit, the same thing happened a bit in Holland, you know? And I lived there, you know? I was at the Maison des Cartes at that time. And I remember that the change that happened with an article of Paul Schreffer, who is mm-hmm. well known in this room, I think.
I guess.
With his multicultural drama. And then what happened with the Twin Towers and everything. And so we must see that in the larger perspective. And I think since a year of 15, things have changed, mm-hmm. and not only in France. The new France, the new Frankreich mm-hmm. is already started somewhere in these years, mm-hmm. just like maybe the new Netherlands. Because mm-hmm. when I come here back, I see a completely different discourse, even in public places, that I used to hear 20 years ago mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. about Europe, about these issues. So, but I have to answer your question. And my fear is, of course, concerning Europe. I think the main danger of the election of Marine Le Pen, maybe not democracy, because I think there is such a long democratic culture in France. No, but we must disagree, Natalie. There is a strong, like in England, I mean, and I think also like in America, and ask Mr. Trump that he's already meeting some problems with the American democracy. So I think this is something I'm rather optimistic. But about Europe, I'm much less optimistic, because I think, and we will have to speak about that, I think, later on, that will become maybe one of the main issues of the election for or against Europe. And the general feeling in France is much more skeptical than in Holland.
You say the power of Marine Le Pen is, for this moment, probably underestimated, if I understand you well. Do you agree? Do you think that she's holding her cards against her chest until the first round of the elections?
It's very hard. That's very hard to say. You know, do opinion polls underestimate her share of the vote? I don't think anybody can really say that with precision. I think that there are probably fewer people who hesitate to say, I will vote Le Pen, mm-hmm. than there were 15 years ago with her father, who reached the second round of the presidential election in 2002. But at the time, in 2002, Jean-Marie Le Pen, on the second round, earned, I think, he gained 18% of the vote. She will probably reach the second round, and she seems set to gain much more than 18% of the vote. One little thing that I think we need to have in mind is that one of the differences, you know, we've made a quick comparison with Brexit. One of the comparisons, and I think there are several French exceptions, and there's not just one French exception. One of the differences is that young people in France are strongly attracted to the Front National. Mm. That's a reality. The 18 to 24, 25-year-olds vote Front National at approximately 39%.
That's astonishing.
This is the reality of France today. The larger group is abstention. Actually, the first party among the young people is abstention, but the first official political party is the Front National. And this certainly was not the case in Britain, if you compare with Brexit. Young people in Britain were overwhelmingly in favor of remaining in the European Union. They were not attracted by the populist rhetoric.
How do we explain this attraction
that?
To the youth?
Again, there will be many versions probably, but my hypothesis is that it all has to do with the economic situation and unemployment, but not just recent unemployment, almost structural permanent unemployment, especially among the young. It's the unemployment rate in France among the young people, 18 to 24, 25, is 24-25%, okay? That's the unemployment rate. In Britain, it's half as much. In this country, I think it's much lower. So this is a French-specific ingredient. And among young people in France who do not have qualifications, who do not have diplomas, you have 46% unemployment. So what we have in France is a generation, a younger generation, that feels it is not given the opportunities. And when you have, and whatever its origins, by the way, of course it's worse for immigrants, children of immigration, but all young people are faced with this reality in France. And when you have that, imagine in any family, when you have a young person who's confronted with this problem, it affects everybody in the family, right? It affects the parents, it affects the brothers, the sisters, everybody's affected. So this, I think, is like the cancer of French society. It's high youth unemployment for decades,
would you
which
agree that
feeds Le Pen,
Thank you. Would you agree that this economic crisis, because it's often said that France goes through more than one crisis at this moment. There is the economic crisis, but there's also the security crisis, the shock of the terrorist attacks. Yeah. And then there's the crisis of identity. Would you agree with Natalie that the economic crisis is the biggest drawer for the Front National?
I think it's very important because that at least makes the difference with Holland. In Holland, you have this identity crisis, clearly. I mean, I just read the electoral programmes of all the parties, and you feel this identity crisis with the Normen and Waarden. And in France, you have that plus a higher security agenda. And don't forget that within 2 years, there were more than 200 people killed. I mean, would that happen in Holland, you know? I don't know what would have been the result of the last elections. And that also, I want to pay tribute to my country, and I will not, don't do that frequently. But since then, believe it or not, so I don't want it to be portrayed as a kind of racist country, because since then, the acts against the Muslims have dramatically diminished by 60% over the last 2 years. So, I mean, this is a sign of democracy, you know?
But it's
not very often said that you have, you didn't have, you know, the anger reaction that you could have seen in other countries.
Revenge actions.
Yes, revenge. You know, and angry. You know.
But still, there are many assaults against mosques and.
No, absolutely not. No, I'm sorry.
Okay, well, you have to.
No, that's not true. We have the figures. I mean, they're given by the High Council. On these questions in France, the point is.
Sorry to interrupt, because I'm still thinking about this point. We hear Simone van der Wetering telling us, and the same goes for Adia's story about the son of his family menage, about these quasi-permanent identity checks.
Yeah,
now, that's not violence, but that is.
No, that's.
But it can be. Perceived as rather violent, actually.
It is. I would say that's segregation. Yeah. No, I mean, I was speaking about precisely the question of Islamophobia and all that. So just remind that it's not exactly what happened, for example, in the United States after some attacks, you know. We did not have that in France. The second thing is the economic crisis, and I totally agree with Natalie. In France, it's not a crisis. It has lasted for the last 30 years. And it's very. I always have to correct my French students when they say, the European crisis. No, it's the French crisis, you know? They didn't know any period in their lives with unemployment under. The best we did was 7% for 1 year, you know? But normally it's around 10%. And for them, as Nathalie said, it's above 20. So that's a fundamental problem. In fact, in France, you have two youth. You have, or even three. You have the youth coming from the immigration that has all the problems we mentioned, plus unemployment and extra unemployment. We have the, let's say, the autochtones, to speak like the Dutch statistics, the autochtones without qualification. And that's the ones who vote for the Front National.
Do you know the word autochtone?
No, I know autochtone in French, but
it's,
not sure.
It's a word that we try to evade nowadays in the media, at least. But it's meant to distinguish between people with a national background for generations back, as opposed to allochtone, that is for the newcomer, the other, the.
But just to pick up on something Christophe said, I take your point about these statistics. Indeed, there have been statistics about the number, if I remember correctly, of anti-Muslim violent acts. Mm. The official statistics went down between 2015 and 2016, but I think they went up in 2015 compared to 2014. It's true that in 2016 they went down compared to the previous year. But I would be careful with these statistics, because the reality is that you do have a society that has moved towards more rejection. That's the reality. It's a society that is now fractured, and of course the terrorist attacks have traumatized France. And this is indeed one of the French exceptions. When we see Western democracies challenged by populism, anti-establishment sentiment, one of the specific French elements is indeed the trauma of these terrorist acts. But it's not just the result of these terrorist acts. It's also the accumulation of years of unaddressed problems, and not just economic ones.
Yeah. I see. Shall we have a look, since it's pretty much about the Front National and Marine Le Pen, this first part of our debate, shall we have a look into what's her program, actually? What is she promising her voters? What's she going to do? Which points in her, she has presented this 144 propositions. That's more than one A4'tje that the PVV from Wilders.
But we love politics and speeches in France. Yes.
And it's good for rhetoric too.
Yeah, so, very good.
In those 144 points, but which one jumps to the eye?
Natalie? I think it's a combination. You do not understand our strength, and we maybe will say a few words about our rhetorical strength, which I think is quite important in politics in general. I think one of her strengths is precisely that she combines the tradition of the extreme right with, economically and socially, a rather left program. Mm-hmm. And that's why also she speaks to the worker of Adrian, you know, because she is for the maintenance of the welfare state. That's why I think it remains an issue. And even for the reinforcement, she wants to hire more civil servants. She wants to give more on a social expenditure. She wants to protect, and that's the combination, the French workers from the competition of the foreigners, including the European ones. So she makes a clever combination, which the father never found. Mm-hmm. Because the father was much more a liberal in the economic field. That's why he did not really speak to the popular classes, you know, because they are attached to this welfare state. And she manages that. And that, I think, makes also her not only the first party among the young, but also among the workers, and by far.
So strong point there. But what's your first?
I think an important thing to say about her is she wants to reach power. She wants to reach
power.
Also
that's the difference. Yeah.
I don't know what the audience thinks, but did Geert Wilders want to reach power? Does he? It's a separate debate, perhaps.
We've stopped trying to understand. What
okay. Okay, but she wants to reach power. Her father, Jean-Marie Le Pen, many people say, never actually wanted to reach power. He was happy being this fringe politician, very provocative, very connected to the history of the far right in France, etc., etc. She has rebranded the party.
Would she be ready? Would she be able to form a government? Does she have the apparatus?
I mean, I think that's jumping too many, you know,
steps.
Too many steps. Okay. What she would, you know, in a nutshell, I think that she is a social nationalist. So that bridges the two elements that Christophe mentioned.
Yes, it's
which
also
is
an inversion of national welfare, socialism.
Well, yes, exactly. So I see her as a social nationalist. You have elements of this in other, you know, national populist movements. So she does try to appeal to low and middle classes who feel disenfranchised, who feel that the elites are not listening to them, that globalization is happening to their detriment. She plays on, of course, the racism that exists in France, although she's much smarter than people who ran the party before her.
She's not racist.
In her rallies, she never says, "I hate Islam" or "I hate Muslims." She will say, "I defend secularism, laïcité. That's what I defend." And everybody in the room understands that that's a message against Muslims, because now in France, a large spectrum of the debate of the political discourse is to say that laïcité, the French brand of secularism, which is a unique thing, actually, it's a unique thing, and I actually kind of like it. I think it's often badly described, which doesn't mean there are not problems, there are huge problems, but I like the law of 1905, which established this. She says that that this is under threat, and everybody in the room will understand, well, yes, of course, it's the Muslims who are threatening it. So she plays on this racism. These are big assets for her, and the fact that she's a woman, that she's divorced, that she smokes, she looks modern, this is also an asset for her. Her weakness, one of her key weaknesses, is that she wants to pull France out of the Eurozone. And actually, many French people actually don't want that. So it's actually a mystery for me. Why is she stupid on this? If she really wants to reach power, she should switch and just say, well, we could, you know, maybe stay in the Eurozone. And
she is, in fact, she's a bit, that's you're absolutely right. This is the main obstacle. I think it was also a main obstacle for Wilders here. Dutch without the euro, I mean, is a nonsense, and the Dutch understand that, I think, more than the French even. But you're right, this is the major obstacle. This is made under the influence of her main advisor, who comes from the left, by the way, and who was Filippo, and who was a left nationalist originally, and who is very anti-European, and he brought that into the mark, let's say, this, what is very important, is that I think she says that she will have a referendum, so that she tried to disconnect the election from the European issue. But of course, people are afraid for a period of chaos, you know. And what Natalie said, the fact that she will be a trouble in Europe, because she said that the day after tomorrow. She will come and change the rules. So, but she has a problem with it. I don't know how she will evolve, but she's, I think, able of changing in order to, we do agree on that. She wants power.
This is a very good bridge to our little entr'acte. And please allow me to switch back to Dutch to introduce something that will happen in French.
We have don't leave the room, huh?
Diriger la France, c'est dur.
I never tried.
pick up our debate after this marvelous little entr'acte. How sure can we be that Marine Le Pen's opponent in the second round, if we take for granted the fact that she'll be in the second round. How sure can we be that Emmanuel Macron, who is now the favorite in the polls, will be her opponent? Do you think that's a done deal, or Natalie?
I don't think anything is a done deal right now. I really think that, you know, even if obviously time is shortening, we now have 3.5 weeks left to the first round. So even if that time frame is narrowing, I think that there are many unknowns, known unknowns, to use a famous expression. And I think the key known unknowns I would mention are the possibility of a terrorist attack,
which would play for
Marine Le Pen, obviously. Especially, I would say, if it's Macron in the second round facing her. Because she will be able to play even more strongly on the strong woman, strong man, authoritarian
and
image.
He would not have the
he
rhetoric.
Would have, he would have less of a, of, I think, although she has, I would say, she has no credibility in that field, as in any, but I think in part of public perceptions he would have. He would struggle to establish himself as a credible reaction to another terrorist attack. Unrest in the suburbs.
I think that's a very important point. Before we continue those other elements, which I'd love to hear too, do you, because rhetoric is your expertise, do you agree? Do you think if, God forbid, another attack would happen, Marine Le Pen would be able to crush Macron in a debate or in the rhetoric that goes about that?
It's very interesting because it's an issue which is absolutely never mentioned in French debate, and a new attack. Because it's,
because
of course,
we don't want to.
It's kind of, don't want that, so we. But everybody has that in mind.
It's a taboo.
And especially when you speak with journalists, you know, they never ask you the question. And after, when you have the talk, they say, and if that happens, you know? Of course, and especially if it happens between the two rounds. Why Macron came very late with the security agenda. He was, you know, he's seen more as the guy for a new economic elan, you know, a new social justice. You know, he's the guy for, is credible and appreciated for that, and of course for his youth. And let's say the Kennedy side, to be quick. Huh? Mm-hmm. And he's also his freedom, the fact that he left the Socialist Party and all that. So he's really the symbol of renewal. The problem is that he came late with the security agenda. He had awkward expressions, to say the least, on several issues. For example, he said there is no French culture, which is something in France that very few people, even on the left side, take for granted, you know. There is a certain feeling that there is a French culture.
It made us Dutch people think of the incident when the then queen-to-be Maxima said that she didn't really distinguish a Dutch identity.
Yes, and you remember, it was in Holland a problem, but she was not running for the presidential election.
No, and she didn't have to.
She didn't have to.
In the meantime, we were still listening to Natalie's
very briefly, unrest in the suburbs. You know, if there's police violence and a cycle of police violence or incidents and unrest, and we know French society is capable of this kind of inflammatory phenomenon where you have a series of.
Well, another, I think you should explain as much as a terrorist attack is a taboo, police violence is something that you speak of up in a phrase like that. Whereas in the Netherlands, things like l'affaire Théo, another incident in the banlieues where a youth was, very badly treated, to say the least, by the police. We don't know things like that in the Netherlands too much. We have one or two incidents which are very well researched by the Openbaar Ministerie afterwards. Yeah. So police violence, you say it as a matter of fact. Does it play a large role?
I do. I was indeed thinking about l'affaire Théo, and I was thinking of another case, Ahmad, I think his name was, a young man, black man, who died after being in police custody. I think this is an old problem in France, and I think that, you know, when we compare our countries, we always have to. This is something I've become obsessed with, living in England and going back and forth and traveling to different European countries. We have to learn our histories better, even the history of our own country. You know, in France, there's so many people who aren't aware of the legacy of the Algerian War, of what it brought. And I'll just, because you're raising the question of police violence, I think there's a connection with all of this. And if perhaps there's some French people in the room, but I don't know if you remember 1983. It seems like a long, long time ago. 1983, there was a socialist president, Mitterrand, and there was something that happened. It was called La Marche des Beurs. It was a march of the first generation of Arab, now we say Muslim, but at the time people said Arab. There's been a slide in vocabulary, which I think is a dangerous distortion, but you know, if you want to label people. Anyway, there was a march of these young people from Marseille to Paris to say, we want rights. We are in 1983, this was 20 years roughly after Algerian independence. We are the first generation to now grow up fully in France after the independence of Algeria, where our parents came from. We want rights. We want to be treated like citizens. Why did they march? They marched because there had been a series of police violence incidents. Young people had died. It was recurrent. Why was there police violence? Because there was a culture within the security forces in France which had roots in the colonial era. We may be now decades from that moment, but I think that these are the things that we have to have in mind if we want to understand what's happening. So that's my worry is unrest.
May
is
I add
unrest.
The popularity of the Front National in police ranks seems to be
yes,
very high.
But we must be fair then. If you want to understand, there's been also severe incidents of violence against the police. And just to give you this example, just a few weeks ago, two policemen were nearly burnt alive. So, I mean, if we mentioned about that, we have to be complete. And this, of course, makes the police very much Front National. And the government was not very good at handling this, you know. Just to give you an example, the President of the Republic went to visit the guy, you know, the poor guy who was attacked by the police, and he did not visit the policeman. And this kind of thing is, of course, symbolically very, very complicated. And of course, you just think of what Marine Le Pen can say about that. I heard she used these examples five times last week, you know? And isn't she rhetorically good?
So we have the risk of a terrorist attack.
Yeah, unrest.
We have police violence?
Yeah. Or violence against the police.
Yeah, unrest in the suburbs, which can be triggered either way. Indeed, I agree with that. But there's been a pattern so far that is started anyway by police incidents. And my third worry is an operation or some phenomenon that which would destroy the reputation or a scandal which would target the opponent of Marine Le Pen, if indeed she's in the second round. This is, you know, we are in this world now where you cannot exclude that there might be big hacking or big disinformation operation. The Front National is extremely active on social media in France, precisely because for decades it felt that it was not being treated fairly by the mainstream media. So it is invested massively in the online world. And that makes it difficult sometimes for the traditional media to detect what's going on, because they're not necessarily in that universe.
This bubble that you spoke of before.
And so some kind of hacking, disinformation, destroying the reputation of the person who is in front of Marine Le Pen. And my final worry is abstention. She will, if people don't go to vote, if many people hesitate to vote because they don't like the guy who is facing her, her
like
chances become ever stronger, ever stronger. It's very important that people go vote in the second
round. So abstention is, we used to speak in terms of turnout.
Low turnout. Yeah, sorry.
Especially because she has, the poll showed that she has the most solid electorate. That means the voters for the Front National will go. And the other, especially Macron, has a low, I mean, conviction of voters. So if these people say, but just imagine that we have Fillon, there is the risk of a great left abstention with all the scandals you mentioned. So a great left abstention, you're saying, okay, Fillon, we can't stand the guy. And then, boom. For the, now I know very well the southern part of France. If it's Macron, many voters for Fillon might and will abstain or vote for Marine.
Why in the south specifically?
Because the south has always been between, let's say, the Republican right and the Front National.
Southeast.
The southeast, yes. Well, now it's the south.
I know, it's also a bit in the west.
Perpignan.
So, okay, here we look at the situation that Marine Le Pen becomes the next president, and we describe it as horror. May I play for a second the devil's advocate and ask you to think of any, is there anything you can mention that you would say, well, that would be a good thing about her presidency? Because, for example, in the Netherlands, sometimes people say, okay, let the extreme right take power. They said that in the 80s already, so that we all can see what a mess they will make of it, and then it will be over and done, for example. Or you mentioned before that the Front National speaks to the la classe ouvrière. Could you think of any positive aspect of it instead of, you know,
the positive aspect?
Yes.
I mean, there is.
I mean, we might all agree that there is none, but there's many people
but
outside.
Your question is a bit ambiguous because you're mentioning the fact that she would frighten off people from voting ever again. So if you call that a positive aspect, I agree with you. But I think the only positive aspect which I see, to be kind, is that it's a bit like Trump's election or the Brexit. It forces Europe and the Europeans to rethink their project and to be. And Natalie just written, I advise you, a very interesting article in The Guardian that you have to rethink, for example, if I'm right, the relation between Europe and the nations. I think Luc van Middelaar, we spoke, and I wrote an article with him in the Figaro last week, in the Figaro. And he really also mentioned that fact that, and you know, he's pro-Europe. But he says that all this populist pressure, at least there's one small advantage that we have to rethink, to redynamize, and Macron is very much in that direction, to give a new impulse, a new momentum to Europe. That's the only thing. The second thing, when you mentioned the risk of that it will frighten everybody off. Now, the last person who did that in the French history is the Queen Marie Antoinette.
We know how she ends.
Yes, and she said, oh, my dear beloved king, let's help the most revolutionary ones, you know? So the king gave his money, his support to Robespierre, you know, the people like that. And you know the end of the story, okay? So I think this is the kind of calculus that is. But some people make it. Some people make it.
No, but I'm asking this
I see
this
no
because
positive aspect whatsoever.
We call it la politique du pire.
But I think your question is interesting because I think you're asking it because you come from a country where there's a parliamentary system and a proportional electoral system. France is different, and I take your point that in a system where there is proportion electoral systems and more parliamentarism than in France, I think it makes sense for populists to have representation. I'm not saying they should be in power, but to have representation, to be sitting in parliament, to be held accountable for how they vote, what they push, what legislation they defend or don't defend, and how they position themselves. In France, the Front National does not have that, right? It doesn't even have a region. And so this has built up an amount of frustration that the voters who like her feel they are not being represented. They don't have a voice. She's the only one. And in France, the institutional setup is such that you only reach for the top job because, as we've heard in those texts that were read, Hollande had never been in any elected office. He arrived in 2012 to the top job in the country where the president in any democracy, in a Western democracy, holds the biggest prerogatives, the strongest concentration of executive power. He discovers what that means. You heard it in those words. He discovered that you can decide life and death. You know, you can send people to get killed. You can order the killing of people, because that, in France, is what the president can do with special forces today in Syria and Iraq. It's not the only country where that happens, but in France, there is a high concentration of power. And you are not accountable. Nobody can destitute you. In fact, you know, no
impeachment.
Impeachment. This wasn't always the case, and to rewind slightly to a comment that Christophe said, that you say our democratic culture in France is deep. I actually don't think it's that deep. Our revolution sounds old now, but our real democratic culture is not that old. Our constitution is from 1958. It was born from a crisis, from a war, the Algerian war, an attempted coup, etc. Our institutions were changed in 1962, only 1962, to allow the direct universal suffrage for the election of the president. Before that, it was a wider mm-hmm. electoral college of locally elected mayors, etc. And so actually our institutions, the way they exist, are not that old. Mm-hmm. And our history in the 20th century is not that perfect, mm-hmm. to say the least, you know, in democratic terms. So I think that a Le Pen presidency from day one would be a disaster. I would see no. And I must add, because I don't want to sound too depressing, that as I said, it's not the likeliest scenario. Macron, now maybe Christophe doesn't like Macron too much, but Macron has been consolidating. That's what opinion polls show. I think Fillon is, his credibility is now on the rocks. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't see how he can have any credibility, especially not to implement reforms that the country needs. And so we have to hope that Macron will hold. Mm-hmm. It's not that I think he's perfect. And there are many mm-hmm. questions to ask about him. But I think that, you know, because of the stakes that we've been discussing, this has to be the hope today in mm-hmm. France.
Hmm. Well, just to close this devil's advocate point, I was asking it also because every time I write an article here or there about the things that are at stake and the possibility of Marine Le Pen's presidency, with the age of Twitter and social media, you have your reactions on whatever you write very quickly. And every time I get reactions like, why do you portray Marine Le Pen's presidency as such a disaster, et cetera, et cetera. And I spent nights behind my computer answering those questions. So I thought I would...
No, that's why we must absolutely take that into account. Otherwise, I mean, she would not be now at 26-28%. You know, that means something. So we have to dig it a bit. But by the way, I'm neither for Macron nor for Fillon. And even less for Marine, but that I think you could understand. So the general idea is that indeed something, you know, because it's a campaign without campaign. It's a campaign about, in fact, it's a judiciary campaign. You know, it's about affaire, as we say. Yeah. Huh? So
scandals.
Yes, yeah. There are one concerning Fillon, or several mm-hmm. concerning Marine. Tomorrow there might be one concerning Macron. You never know. Or between the second round, and something else which I want to add, and we must, I think, take that into account, what will the Russians do? Mm. Because it's clear, that choice is very clear mm. between Macron and Marine. Huh? What will they do?
Will they
try to influence with revelations? Uh-huh. It's also, I would say, that's the fifth
element
of risk. So. It's really, I think we do agree on that. It's so open. For the first round, I also agree that things now are getting in this direction. But there is one risk, only one risk for Macron. And this is a risk which will increase in the coming weeks, that all the socialists are joining him, or most of them. Mm-hmm. And that will go on and on and on. Mm-hmm. And that the risk, of course, because the French, it's clear, they want, that's why Hollande is not candidate, they want a change mm-hmm. with the mm-hmm. government. So it will be Macron, Fillon or Le Pen, a change.
So too much socialist in his bark.
Well, that makes a bit suspicious, you understand? Mm. Yes. And this, the danger, if the idea comes in the mind of the people that Macron is the candidate of the media and Hollande new look, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. That could be, you know, a change of momentum.
I understand.
And that's why he's so clever. That's why when a socialist minister comes to him, he says, please, wait. And rather cleverly, the right wing is playing more and more
yes,
on that.
They try to.
Yeah. And we know, everybody knows that Hollande has a kindness for Macron, despite uh-huh. the fact that he betrayed him. But uh-huh. he speaks of that as a kindness for Macron. So if the idea in the French mind, which is not yet the case, is that Macron is a kind of new sexy version of François Hollande,
then
it could be very dangerous for him.
in the meantime, I want to ask you people in the audience to start formulating your possible questions. You can do that in Dutch, in English, or in French. Don't hesitate, feel frank, speak out. There will be a microphone around. And while you think of those questions, I will ask you one more, because after the presidential elections, we will also have the parliamentary elections. How do you think that will play out if Le Pen would be president? What would happen in the month of June then?
I want to make a tiny correction, because I said earlier that Hollande had never held elected office. That's not true.
Ministerial office.
Exactly. He was an MP. He was an MP from Corrèze. He represented the region, yes, of the département de Corrèze.
No executive.
But he was never in government. He was never a minister. He was never.
He said it himself. Yeah. I mean, we can ask him. He's still in the room. Mm-hmm.
About the legislative elections, it's possible. What's happened in France is that the mainstream parties that dominated, simply put, since the post-war, basically, are now exploding. They are exploding. Mm. The Socialist Party is exploding. It's completely fragmented. Disputes everywhere. Personal hatreds and antagonistic relations, etc. On the right, the Les Républicains. Mainstream party has also exploded again over issues that also divide the socialists, whether it's Europe, economic reform, diversity, secularism, etc. There's these dividing lines are everywhere. So it's quite unpredictable what might come out of the legislative election. Certainly the Front National is going to come in for the first time in an important way, but it's possible that we might have an almost impossible majority, or such a legislative body that would be so divided and volatile that perhaps it would be impossible to govern. Mm. And of course, that might sound like a reassuring thing if you have Marine Le Pen, but actually, nothing will be reassuring about a Le Pen presidency, and neither is it reassuring even if you have a Macron presidency. Indeed, the same question applies.
That's a big illusion of the right wing in France, that Macron would not have a majority, because I'm sure he can have. I mean, it will not be a very solid and lasting one, but it will be a Dutch coalition. You know what I mean? You know how to build it. Huh? So Macron has really the possibility to make a kind of CDA, D66, VVD something, and the rest of the PVDA, because there is something in common, is that the Socialist Party in France is just in the same situation as the Dutch PVDA. Mm. Okay? But he has a possibility maybe to have, I totally disagree with the hopes of the right on that, the French right. I think he has a possibility, and also, let's be fair, the politicians, and that's not only French. I mean, you go where success is, what I mean? And if the winner is the winner. So suddenly you have more fans. Have you noticed that in political life? So I think that he will have, at least in the beginning, a majority. And that's a huge mistake, I think, of the right analysis.
Still, if I try to sum up a little bit our conversation, I remember that when we invited you, Christophe, for this evening, and we said that the title would be A New France, you suggested that we change it into France at the Verge of the Abyss.
In Dutch, even.
Even in Dutch, you said it. En Frankrijk aan de rand van de afgrond, stelde Christophe toen voor. Unfortunately, in hindsight, I think that we might have done that given your, pessimistic feelings of this moment, if I may say so. Would it have been a better title?
Well, no. I don't. The word "new" is like there's. It's a word that can say so many different things. So it can be new in a very bad way, and it can be new in a good way.
That's what we
I prefer new.
Anyway, it's a changing France. Yeah. That's clear. It's a changing France.
And a change in Europe too. Now I will stand up to look you in the eye better than I can from this chair.
journalist.
Heeft iemand een vraag? Helemaal achterin zie ik al meteen een hand. Als er vertaald moet worden, dan doe ik dat. Desgewenst.
Hi, thank you for your debate. What is the French election going to mean on the international stage? Is there a prospect of... Because I know the apocalyptic scenario, but is there a prospect of a stronger France, of a France that does play a role in Europe? Is it does something as a counterweight to Merkel's economic policy? Is there any prospect or any ideas? Do you have any ideas on that?
Christophe, you want to...
I didn't get a prospect of what exactly?
Of a stronger France in the European concert, if I sum up your question right.
Since it has lost its role it had on the Sarkozy.
Oh, yes. Yeah. No, that's right. Well, I think it would... That would be the case if you had, which was a possibility at the time, to have a duel between Fillon and Macron, and that would have been really interesting, democratically interesting. I think in these two cases, because both agree on that, that the fact that the Hollande presidency were not very effective, to say the least, on the European level, and France was rather passive, and that I have so many... friends in Brussels who told me that. But so they, when you see the two programs, which are different, of Fillon and Macron, they are very, very active on the European front and on the European action of France. And they both agree on something else, which is quite important and quite new in France. They both say that France has to do something about its own reforms, okay, to recover economically so that her voice should be more heard in Europe. That's the common points between Fillon and Macron. So that is, in that sense, they are both very far from Marine Le Pen. That's, I think, and that's, in fact, the issue. Did I answer your question? More or less?
Stay count up. Yeah. That's it.
I would like to know, what is your view on the support of Marine Le Pen among people with university degrees? Because we know she has support from workers, unemployed. But what is your feeling about her support from university people? And maybe is it the case that the polls do not reflect that support?
I haven't seen any statistics concentrating specifically on university teachers or personnel. No. But it's true that years ago, this was probably four or five years ago, when we weren't in this situation, I remember having a discussion with somebody who knew about universities much better than I did in France, and especially the universities in provincial capitals like Rennes and others. And he said to me, "Le Front National is setting up roots in these places, and it's very active." And that's one thought. And my other thought is, there is an ideology that the Front National carries, which has proponents among parts of the French intellectual class today, and it goes all the way from theories that in French, le grand remplacement, you know, which is basically our population, our white Christian populations in Europe are being slowly replaced by non-white, non-Christian populations. This has been theorized and written about, and there's a whole group of people who have diplomas who write books about this and debate it. And to people who, and you know, to people who I would say plug into the Putin narrative, which exists in Europe also in parts of the far right, which is that on an international level, we are part of a civilization that is under assault by the southern Muslim world, and we must stick together and
the great Christian alliance.
Let's get rid of these liberals who weaken us, who make us decadent with gay marriage and things like that. Marine Le Pen doesn't say that, by the way. That's the general sense, and I think that if maybe that's one thought that comes to my mind when I hear your question. We do live in that world where these ideas have solid intellectual bases. They exist and they're spread and they're upheld by powerful people.
But we must never forget not only ideas but interests. And what is clearly shown by the statistics is that the voting intentions for her are rising quickly in the civil servants, and including the teachers at school. And we know that, that is for sure, because I have friends who are studying that closely, that this is underestimated, that more people will vote for her and not, and do not say that because you are not supposed to vote for Marine Le Pen in a schoolroom, you know that? So the idea is that she, and that's the left part of our program. You mentioned rightly the extreme right, which attracts intellectuals, but I know that in Holland there are some intellectuals interested also with these ideas, if you know whom I mean. Huh? Yeah. So we have some Thierry Baudets in France as well. Huh? And he has a French name, hasn't he, after all? Huh? So the idea of these people is different. They say, they think that it's in her program, she will guarantee the welfare state, the high employment of civil servants, more civil servants, the rise of their treatments of them, and they are rather a bit short, I can tell you, I'm one of them. And these people, and the programs of Macron and Fillon, especially Fillon, but even Macron, are a little more tougher for the, a little more bezuinigend, okay? Mm-hmm. And you do know this word, huh? And I could not find the English word, so it's so Dutch, this word, bezuiniging. and she, you understand? So there is also the voice of interest. These people, we'll see, it would be very interesting why she's so popular now, also in the police, also in the teachers, also in the SNCF, you know? All these votes which think that she will preserve the modèle français, you know, whereas both Macron and Fillon want to change it more or less radically.
Ik zie nog een hoop handen, Tim.
Ça compte, hein, mon micro-temprof.
Ja, nou, het lijkt me zo fijn om dan weer een dame aan het woord te laten, maar die hebben hun vragen nog niet paraat, zo te zien. Ah, ja.
Il y en a beaucoup.
Monsieur, ça trous.
Bonsoir, je vais vous poser deux questions en français. Vous dites que le Front National est sous-estimé, mais avant les sondages, on les faisait, enfin les gens venaient poser des questions avec des micros et on voyait les gens. Maintenant, tout est quasiment fait par Internet. Donc les gens n'ont plus peur de dire qu'ils votent pour Marine Le Pen, parce que de toute façon, c'est anonyme. Donc je ne suis pas sûre que ce soit si sous-estimé que cela.
Je peux répondre ?
In let French me, or English? Translate the question into Dutch.
Oh, sorry, yes.
Merci, Pascal. De opmerking is dat de onderschatting van het Front National electoraat in de peilingen misschien niet zo groot is als vanavond is gezegd, omdat mensen tegenwoordig meestal per internet worden ondervraagd en dus niet meer die politiek correcte reflex bij het beantwoorden van een vis-à-vis ondervraging hoeven te ondergaan, maar op internet gewoon in de beschermde omgeving van hun eigen huis waarschijnlijk kunnen zeggen, ja, ik stem voor die of die partij.
Yeah, it's a very good I can answer in English. It's a very good technical remark. Natalie, neither me said that in general the Front National is underestimated. I just spoke about among the civil servants and especially among the teachers. Why? Because there, this is qualitative interviews, which are much more personalized, and also where the tradition of being more left, okay, is much more present. So it's not me, in fact, that the vote of these categories could be higher for her, but not in general. You're absolutely right. It will be now a question of two points. You know what I mean? It's not like we're dead anymore. That's clear. But still, she's at 20. Today she was again at 28, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, that means that she can reach the 30% at the first round. And if she reaches 30% at the first round, it creates, and that's why I totally agree with Natalie, it's so difficult to predict already the first round, so even less the second round. Because I think the second round will not be played on the issue Marine Le Pen or not Marine Le Pen. That was for the father. The question will be, and believe she will ask the question, for globalization or against globalization? And then the answer, that's also important. And she's very good. Now I come back to rhetoric, you know. She's very good at setting the agenda. So she will say, no, I'm Mr. Macron, it's not me. It's not a question of you and me. It's a question of for globalization or against globalization. And when you see the polls in France on this issue, the answer is very different. You have a majority of French who are afraid. And that's completely different when you see the Dutch statistics. The Dutch, that's why I was never afraid for builders, the Dutch are pro-globalization in general. The French, the majority of the French now is against it. So you see, that's also an important element. What will be the agenda of the second round? And my inclination is to think that she's so clever and so good in debating. And you know, we have a debate, very important debate, that she could convince people on that issue that it is the issue, which is completely fake, of course.
You speak of the debate of the 20th of April?
Or no, between the second round, the decisive one, you know? And debates are important, and especially that one. And if she manages to put the agenda on that issue, with playing on, if we say Macron, well, if we say Macron, playing on the fact that he works with banks, you know, in France, it's not good to work in banks. That's also different from Holland, you know. No, it's not good. There is still something against businessmen in politics in France. It's still there. And she will play on that, you know. You are the elite, you are Enarch, you are Inspector des Finances, you are a banker, you are the global interest, etc., etc. Now, it's time for the guy to be at the level.
Het is al na tienen, dus we moeten een beetje op de tijd gaan letten. Maar ik wil graag nog aan één vraagsteller het woord geven. Ik vind het moeilijk om het te kiezen. Nou ja. Mogen het er nog twee zijn, Tim? Jij bent... De strengste van ons twee.
Okay. Our societies were held together by the Judeo-Christian worldview with its counterpart humanism. What would be the new worldview to sustain our societies, which give people hope, an orientation point, identity?
Did you get it?
Yeah. Can I just, you said our societies were held together by Judeo-Christian traditions or background, and you added something, and...
Humanism as its counterpart.
Mm. I mean...
What is the question exactly? Because I think we were interrupted by the gentleman leader. What would
be onze samenlevingen werden bij elkaar gehouden door de Joods-christelijke... een Joods-christelijk wereldbeeld met als tegenspeler het humanisme. Mm-hmm. Wat zou het nieuwe wereldbeeld voor onze samenlevingen moeten zijn om de samenleving bij elkaar te houden en hoop te geven aan mensen, betekenisverlening en ook een oriëntatie?
Ik begrijp de vraag, maar waar is de Franse connectie?
Well, you don't understand what I'm saying?
I guess I do, if you want to switch back to English.
Okay, well, now just let, it's okay then.
The gentleman was asking where in the new worldview the old Judeo-Christian background of our story counterbalanced with the humanist story.
Should we add other religions, other ideas?
Yeah.
Does that answer your question from Adrian van Dis? But I'm afraid we are very much leaving the French topics here, and we have already run out of time. So let's keep this for the bar.
Yeah, okay.
In France. Well, in fact, I can answer for it's clear that she, less than her father, and even less than Fillon, Marine Le Pen is not playing so much on the Christian roots and never about the humanist tradition. I never heard the word. That's also something rather new. She comes with a new type of populism that we have seen also. I didn't have the impression that Trump was really a newborn Christian. Huh? And this is also, we have to also, that's always what I said also to my students, but we have also to change our, you know, our pattern of analysis, because these are also new phenomena. And things are changing. It's not the exactly like the extreme right of the father. It's not. It's really something a bit new. She says very different things about the Islam. I heard her once saying that Islam was compatible with the Republic, which you would never hear the equivalent in Wilder's mouth. Huh? Mm-hmm. So she's really playing on many, many, let's say, registers. And she, I think, she doesn't play so much on the cultural, and she plays much more on the idea of the French way of life, let's say.
Mm. One more. I keep saying.
It's a really tough question to ask at this stage, but you've both analyzed the current situation, what might happen, but I'm really curious to know what the two of you think is necessary in France at the moment. If you could decide the elections, what were the top things that you'd want to see happen? The top things that you would like to see happen. If I think of the banlieue and the sense of alienation, the reforms that might be necessary or not. France is the only country that still has a permanent seat at the Security Council after Brexit. How do the two of you see what should happen in France? Because it seems like it's quite a limited option right now between these four candidates. Tough question.
Well, in a nutshell, I think France needs jobs for its young people. I think that's the absolute urgency. A lot of the other problems come from that vacuum, a lack of opportunity, despair. You know, when you don't have opportunities, you don't have any. You feel that society is just one great big wall that's being built in front of you. You look for other options, or you just sort of go off politically or otherwise. So I think that's an essential thing. I think there's another thing which was missed during this socialist presidency, which is, especially in the aftermath of the terrorist attacks, and especially because we have a fractured society that has not gotten to grips with its parts of its own history, I think there was a message was required from the very highest office to reach out to all the diversity of this society and to say, you know, we are all part of one country with values, with traditions, a background. Our history is something that we share. It may have very strong tensions within it, but we are all in this together. And this was not said after those terrorist attacks. What was said was, we will implement new security measures. You know, we will consider withdrawing citizenship from terrorist offenders if they have dual citizenship. All these things that, you know, the security measures, of course, were necessary, but the message that people, especially many of the young people in France, needed to hear should have been a much more embracing, forward-looking message, not a message that, as Adrian mentioned, you know, this retreat within ourselves. One of the terrible things that happened after these terrorist attacks in France is that Hollande and the whole government tried to cast the terrorist attacks as the result of an attack from foreigners far away, you know, in the Middle East. We know that the Middle Eastern crises have impacted Europe in many ways, but these terrorist attacks in France were carried out by people who were born and bred in France. They are French citizens with two, I think, exceptions. This needed to be addressed, and it's one of the things that Macron has spoken about, but he's very careful about this.
It's a very slidey subject. It's very, very, very sensitive, it's sure. But indeed, I totally agree with the first issue is really jobs, and jobs for everyone, exactly what you said. Yeah? And then because this is difficult to imagine in Holland, because in Holland you have ups and downs, you know, but every 3 or 4 years it comes up again. Okay.
Well, thanks for so much positivity.
But in France, it once again it has been, it has been lasting for 30 years. Mass unemployment. So this is this changes the country after a while, you know, and especially in the in the younger generations. When I said the younger generations, until 40, you know. So this has to be addressed. And this is why, of course, the Marine solution, Marine Le Pen solution, are really just what you must not do. So now there are only two realistic, I mean, who could be Dutchified economic programs, which are reasonable. But there is also one thing which is, and that's my final point, is that, and that's what makes me a little more frightened than maybe than Natalie on that issue, is that the economic culture of the French is not huge in comparison. We have all the statistics in Europe. In comparison with the economic culture of the Dutch, I mean, Marine Le Pen says things that would be simply, you cannot, would not be taken in Holland by anyone, okay, in the economy, the economic policy. Wilders never says what she says on the economic policy. And we have many candidates who say things which for the Dutch would be simply crazy, okay? But in France, we have a low economic culture for historical reasons, and that makes, you understand me, that makes her program and her rhetoric acceptable for many people.
So I think if we can conclude that the presidency of France should be a tandem job from now on, and that we have the two perfect first candidate for this tandem job, you would accept Adrien van Dis as a Minister of Foreign Affairs and Cultural Businesses? I think that's at least a positive note to end this evening on. I thank you all very much for your attention. Natalie, Nougayrede, Christophe de Voogd, merci beaucoup. Adrien van Dis, zeer hartelijk dank. Pieter van der Meulenbroeke, Sophie, Simone.